Can we invite the administration team in, please? There is a quorum and it's the time, so please invite the representatives in. Let's deal first with item one, confirmation of minutes. Members, please confirm the minutes of the meeting held on the 15th of December 2015. The paper number is CB(1506/1516). To date, the Secretariat has not received any proposed amendments. So let's confirm the minutes. Welcome, the administration team. Let's pause for a while. We've formed a quorum and we've got already started the meeting, but then there is only me who is in the room, because at the same time there are meetings of several other bills committees going on. So let's wait for a while. Thank you. Well, the other meeting has already started. All right. Attending this meeting is the administration team comprising the original team. Mr. Donald Ng, Deputy Director of Environmental Protection, I believe this is the first time that you're attending the meeting. For the rest of the team, I'm sure that you are all familiar with them. So let's continue with scrutinizing the bill. Matters arising. Let me brief you. The government has responded to issues of concerns raised by members at the meeting on the 11th of January, and they've also proposed some CSAs. And the paper number is CB(1510/1516/02). So, administration, can you please first brief us on this paper? The CSAs are rather important, so we have to understand them thoroughly. Who to take us through? Mr. Ng. Thank you, Chairman. Let me brief you on the salient points of the paper, and then I'll defer to my colleagues to take you through some other points. In the last meeting and the previous meetings, members have raised concerns on the definition of beverage. In previous meetings, we said that if we use an exhaustive list for beverage, then this would not be practicable. Because there may be new beverage products coming out in the market, and if we have to do a frequent legislative updating, then that's not very good. So at the same time, we know that we need to set up clearer definitions of the beverage so that everyone is well aware of what kinds of beverage will be subject to regulation. To strike a balance, we are now proposing to amend the definition of beverage. There will be two types of beverage, and that is set out in paragraph 2A. A ready-to-serve drink. We have set out different examples: alcoholic drink, water, milk or dairy-based drink, soya bean-based drink, fruit or vegetable juice or nuts, etc. So these are similar to what we have set out in the in previous papers. The other type is a product that is a commonly substances drink after being diluted or reconstituted. That includes fruit concentrate, vinegar concentrate, yes, and we think that these should also be included in the definition of beverage. In the last meeting, we also discussed whether beverage or products already diluted with water would come under the definition. So after our refined or amended definition, so such products would also be covered under the bill. And at the same time, we think that our focus should be on beverage. So in other words, products in solid form or jelly form, they should not be covered under the bill. Last time, the members also raised about collagen drink or health supplements. Now, if the suppliers are marketing them as beverage, should they be covered? And in our paper this time, we said that based on the amended definition of beverage, such products, because they are marketed as beverage, so there is no reason that we should not treat them as beverage for the purpose of the regulation under the bill. So if the suppliers market them as beverage, they should be covered under the bill and the regulation as well. As for the definition of regulated articles, I would like to defer much to my colleague to take you through. Mr. Lai, Chairman, members have asked questions on definitions of some terms. So for paragraphs 6 to 10, we have set out our responses point by point. Paragraph 6 to 7 respond to members' concern on regulated articles. Now, we are amending the two ordinances here. One is the PERO, and they are mainly concerned with regulated articles, and the other ordinance to be amended is the waste disposal ordinance, and that targets container waste. And members were asking whether these the definitions of these two terms are consistent. Our explanation is that for regulated articles, they will be regulated under a phased approach, and initially we will include beverages held in glass containers, and that was set out in Schedule 6, and which enables us to implement the regulation in a phased approach. So the beverages held in glass containers be targeted. But under the waste disposal ordinance, we are targeting container waste. Now, for glass containers, if they are disposed as waste, and it will be difficult to prove or recognize whether these have been used for holding beverage or other products. So our approach is that if it is a glass container, then it will come under the definition of container waste. So these are the considerations that we have. So these are the complementary measures set out in these two ordinances. Now, paragraph 8 is in response to members and legal advisors' concern, and that is there is no definition for glass container under the bill. Well, compared to the plastic bag levy, we have come up with a definition of the plastic bag saying that it is made of plastics. But the background to that other ordinance is different. For plastic bag levy, we want to cover paper bags as well. Paper bags which may contain some elements of plastic, for example, is laminated with plastic. So that's why we have to set that out clearly in that other ordinance. But for this bill, we see that we are targeting glass containers, but whether it comes with a metallic cap or plastic labels is not a relevant consideration. So even if it comes with a metallic cap or plastic label, it will not be stand in the way of it being defined as a glass container. So there is no further elaboration on that. Paragraphs 9, well, members have asked that since we discussed the definitions of beverage and containers last time, so under existing laws in Hong Kong, are there any similar references in other pieces of ordinance? So we have done a search and we've listed a list of ordinances which are set out in the annex. And overall, different ordinances have different regulatory approaches, so they may not be of good reference to us here. For beverage, say for example, they would cover whether water and milk beverage should be subject to regulation. So the consideration in these ordinances should not be the same as ours at this time. And container refers to all types of containers and so on. So that's why we said that we don't need to come up with a definite definition for glass containers. So these are all set out for members' reference. Paragraph 10 has to do with consume. Well, the legal advisors raised a point which accepts, and so that's why we come up with a CSA. Overall, for the regulated articles, it should be a glass beverage container which has been sealed, but if it is open up or it is abandoned, we will see this as being falling under the definition of consume here. So that's a response to the legal advisor's point. Now, paragraph 11, members last time asked us to explain or assess whether the bill will encourage the suppliers to switch to other containers. From the information that we have, most of the beverages held in glass containers are alcoholic drinks, and for beer, maybe aluminium cans will be used instead. But we don't think that would be very common, because for the sake of product quality, alcoholic drinks will not be contained in, say, paper packaging or other types of packaging. And in paragraph 12, we said that if there is a registration process, how many days will that take? We have taken reference from the levy on plastic shopping bags, and we estimate that it will be around 21 days, as long as we've got the full set of information. Paragraph 13 sets out the CSAs in Annex B after taking into consideration all the points raised. And the CSAs do not include the new definition of beverage. Well, depending on the Bills Committee's discussion, we will add that in later. We have made CSAs based on the WEEE bill and also the points that set out in this paper. So much for my briefing here. Members, these are the responses to concerns raised by members, and CSAs have also been put forward. So members, you can further ask questions or make comments. I think the more important points are related to the definitions. I think they have followed good advice. They have taken heed of our views expressed in the last few meetings. So they have amended the definitions. In previous meetings, we have cited certain examples. And at that time, the government said that if, according to the existing definition, those beverage products will not be covered under the bill. But under this new definition, such beverage products will be covered. Let me cite an example.
In the last few years, vinegar drinks have become very popular, although traditionally vinegar is regarded as condiment, but we have many vinegar drinks in the market. According to the paper, in paragraph 2, definition B, that is a product that is a liquid or consists of liquid and it commonly serves as a drink after being diluted and reconstituted. I think that would cover the vinegar drinks, and I think it's reasonable because indeed we do have such products in the market which are promoted as beverages which can be drink on a daily basis. So the government is no longer adopting the more narrowed concept. So vinegar in diluted form and sold as a beverage will now also be included. So I think this amendment is important. So so members are welcome to ask questions regarding the administration's response. Anyone? No comments? Ms. Sito, and then Mr. Raymond Chan. I think it is not our intention to make things difficult for the officials. We just want them to tell us clearly what is covered and what is not. Last time we pointed out that beverages could be in powder form, which can... We're not nitpicking. We just want your amendments to give a clear explanation. Mr. Raymond Chan, it's not our intention to, you know, make things difficult for the government. We are not nitpicking, but indeed we have seen actual examples to make us ask whether or not the bill is not clear enough. For example, you say a product that is a liquid or consists of liquid. If we accept that, then you know, Horlick in powder form will not be included because it's not in liquid form. But what about the pomelo drink in a jelly form contains liquid? You can't say that it does not. If you say that it is not served as a drink, of course it could be used as a jam, you know. But in paragraph 3, you say these products will not be included because they are not in liquid form, they're in jelly form. So how does one deal with jelly in other legislation? It is a food product, and that's why it's not covered in the bill. But I think they do contain liquid. I can give one example for the administration to consider. Before they respond, I want to say that when I talk to the officials about their amendments, I don't think the officials are saying that we are making things difficult for them. We have set up a bills committee to scrutinize the bill exactly because we want to do a good job. I think that is our common purpose. You say whether a product is in liquid form or consists of liquid. I think the two, are not the same. In physical form, of course, jelly would contain liquid. So what do you mean by not in a liquid form? Because, a jelly may also contain liquid. So how would you respond to that, Deputy Director? Thank you. I'd like to thank members for all your available views, and our amendments have been proposed after we've considered the suggestions by members. Mr. Chen asked a question regarding products which are in jelly form or powder form. In paragraph 3, we say that overall speaking, these are not sold in liquid form, they're not sold as a beverage, and therefore they will not be included under the definition. We understand your point about, in solid form or in powder, because they don't contain liquid and they're excluded. But jelly is different. So how would you define a jelly, and would you agree, would you say whether or not it is in non-liquid form? I think we've considered similar products. Other than pomelo drinks, you may have a small container where kids can squeeze some jelly from that container. I think basically by beverage we mean water or products in liquid form. As to how this should be, the product should be drafted, in paragraph B2, we say that it should be a product which is in a liquid form and is commonly served as a drink after being diluted or reconstituted, and therefore products like jelly will not be included. But after providing for these two criteria, does it mean that products in jelly form will not be included? Well, I'm citing the example of the pomelo tea, which is like jam, would fall into a gray area. For pomelo drinks, since it is called pomelo drink, it is, you know, meant for consumption. So I think we seem to have a gray area here. So how would you deal with that, Chairman? I think in our internal discussion, we've also looked at such products. If it is mainly used as a drink after dilution, then I think the way we draft the definition here, we can include that. But I don't think we should also include products which are, you know, jellies. But pomelo drink is quite similar. If it is a jam, which is not meant to be diluted and drunk. Of course, you can, you know, dilute the jam and drink it, but it's not marketed in the market for this purpose. And they're different from pomelo tea. So having heard the officials' answers, it would appear that pomelo tea can be included, but not jam. Chairman, I think we just want to clarify things. If you include pomelo drink, how about honey? Because honey can also be diluted and drunk. I mean, this is only my speculation. Correct me if I'm wrong. When you talk about beverage, originally you were thinking in terms of, the administrative, arrangements. If you need to collect these drinks, you need to rinse it. But for honey and pomelo tea, you may not be able to clean it simply by rinsing it. And then they will be taken to the landfills because the recyclers cannot collect them, like plastic bottles. I'd like to repeat once again that we are not nitpicking here, but whether it's the definitions or the actual operations, I think you need to come up with something that is clearly defined. So have you talked to the recyclers whether or not after they've collected the containers, do they need to be rinsed and cleaned as well? I don't think they need to be cleaned either. I think we can have another contractor to clean them up for recycling. So I don't think it should be the case that any container which is not clean will all be taken to the landfill. So in your original, when you first formulated the proposal, did you include this as well? So we have another example, honey. Honey is also in liquid form, although it's thicker. I think members' views are very clear. We're not deliberately asking you to include a particular product. But I think your definition will need to be clear so that it will not be misleading and people will inadvertently, break the law. Deputy Director, regarding honey, we also have, discussed this matter among ourselves, and members have also cited this example whether or not we should cover it under a definition. According to paragraph 2b, if honey is diluted and used as a beverage, then it should be included as well. How about, topping a chicken wing with honey during a barbecue? So sometimes honey is diluted and consumed as a beverage, and other people may use it at barbecues. Of course, that's why we have provided a clearer indication in the paper. The two scenarios described by Ms. Ho, whether honey which is consumed and money, honey which is contained in the bottle, it's not so difficult to come up with a definition. So if it is in liquid form and it is diluted and consumed as a beverage, and we would include them. Chairman, I hope they will also include honey. From the environmental perspective, the bigger the coverage, the more I would welcome that. I've raised that point earlier because you need to have some clear arrangements with the recyclers, and you should require them that if there are such honey jars which have not yet been cleaned or jars containing pomelo tea, there should be a procedure for them to hire workers to clean such containers. And they should not. I mean, just they see some honey stuck in the at the bottom of the bottle, they will throw them to the they take them to the landfills. Mr. Wuchiwai? Thank you. My understanding is that the whole concept is that we are adopting the concept of clean recycling. You say you do not, recycle containers for soy or sauces. So whether it's pomelo tea or honey, they should not be covered in the definition. Otherwise, the concept is becoming more and more difficult. That's my point. Honestly, you will not be able to exhaust all the possible glass containers anyway. If in this bill, it is your starting point that you only want to cover the typical or common beverages such as soft drinks, alcoholic beverages, and so on, if you say you also want to include, substances in semi-liquid or jelly form, anyway, something which is not in solid or liquid form, something that is, rather thick. Of course, you can further argue, one can also ask, how about concentrated fruit juice, which is, so I think it should be your principle that you should only include products in liquid form. Although I don't think you should include, honey and products in semi-liquid form, because it would make the enforcement of the whole ordinance difficult. And just for a small portion of the glass containers, you need to come up with a very complicated definition, and I don't think that is sensible. So you have to think about your objective. Remember that you're not providing a cover-all definition. That's not so. So that's the point I'd like to add, Chairman. Mr. Ng, regarding the scope of the bill, I'd like to emphasize that we would like to, start with the concept beverage, and we will not include glass containers containing non-beverages. But having heard members' comments, we've now decided to come up with a clear definition as to whether or not we should only include products which are in liquid form. In the paper, we also say that the product should be a liquid or a liquid form and consumed as a beverage. Only then will the product be included. I think so we don't have any differences here, Mr. Wu. I think we had a long debate about pomelo tea and so on. Mr. Wu, I think we discussed the several examples earlier, and they're all in liquid form. They're not in non-liquid form.
You also mentioned about fruit juice. They may be in fruit concentrates, and they can be diluted with water before it is consumed as drink. So this amendment is made in response to the examples we cited earlier, because in the market, there are products which exist in liquid form, and they can only be consumed after they've been diluted with water, and they are indeed marketed in the market as beverage. So if they are excluded from the coverage, then there will be confusion, because you are marketing these as beverages and you are not including them as beverages under the bill. So that's why they come up with this amendment in the definition. But if you are talking about a non-liquid form, jelly form, that would not be covered under the bill. Well, just now they said that the pomelo tea drink will be included. Well, as we just discussed, well, it's not true to say that pomelo tea is not in liquid form. It's just that it's thicker, and it can be consumed as a drink after it's diluted with water. Actually, at the coffee corner on the fifth floor, we do provide such products. And before you came in, the answer was that it should be covered under the bill. Mr. Ng, do you have anything to add? Your understanding is correct, Mr. Chairman. So we go by the principle you mentioned. Chairman, I just want to say that you may be right in your principle, but as what Ms. Sitho said, in your recycling procedures, do you want to cover those products as well? Think about it. I don't mind one way or another. Well, in any case, you are not covering all glass containers. If that is the case, then I will not argue with you. If you cover all glass containers, 100%, then I will not have a problem with this. But if that is not the case, and if we are covering certain glass containers now first, and if we are to cover these other products, is it worthwhile to do it? I believe that Mr. Ng has heard your views. My personal view is that no matter how you set out your definition, there are certain products which can be covered or cannot be covered. But anyway, we've cited examples previously, and that is, if there are products which are consumed as drinks, and then they are marketed so as well, and if we go by the Codex definition as previously proposed, that will not be included in the coverage of the bill. But many members have raised that this approach is not reasonable. So that's why they have dealt with our suggestions this time. No matter how you draft the definition, there are bound to be products which may or may not be included. Now say, if indeed there are such products which may or may not come under the definition, you have a channel to consult the trade, as we said previously. After the bill has been passed, how will we be implementing it? We will liaise closely with the trade as to what kind of beverages, what kind of containers will be included. We will discuss all these with the trade. If in future there is new product coming into the market and we're not clear about whether it should be covered, then we would go by the drafting of the bill, and we would discuss with the trade as to whether the new products should be covered under the ordinance. Thank you. Mr. Kwok Wai Kang, do you have a suggestion? Right. Mr. Kwok, thank you, Chairman. I have a question for the administration. Have you assessed, with the new definition, i.e. including the pomelo tea? Well, my understanding was that you did not originally propose to include it. So the scope has been broadened. The volume of containers to be dealt with will increase. Do you have capacity downstream to deal with the expanded volume of containers? That's my first question. Second question. The new definition may also be subject to controversies. Do you mean that for the importers or manufacturers, they would just register with you first, and then whether they have to pay the levy, then it will be up to you to tell them whether they have to pay the fee, or will they decide on their own whether their drinks will be covered? Mr. Ng? According to the new definition, will it be the case that there will be a substantial increase in the volume of containers covered under the bill? That will not be the case, because as we said, over 80% of the beverage in glass containers are alcoholic drinks. So we are coming up with a clearer definition, so there will not be any ambiguity. Will that be a substantial increase in the number of glass containers to be dealt with? That should not be the case. As to how the arrangement will be like in the future, I will defer to Mr. Lai. In terms of the levy mechanism, it will be for the suppliers to make a declaration or return, and then they will take reference from us, our guidelines as to what products that should be subject to the levy, and then they will periodically report to us the volume of containers that they have dealt with, and then they will be charged a levy. Every year, an auditor will audit the statistics. Of course, the government will also make inspections. In the bill, we said that if during the inspections the suppliers are paying less than required, there is a mechanism for us to chase after them. We will liaise closely with the trade, and if needed, for special products, we might issue certain guidelines. That's what we will do. Further questions? Thank you, Chairman. Alcoholic drinks make up the bulk of the beverage. That's understandable. Well, even if for the other drinks, beverages, which is in the minority, we're still concerned about it. It will be the for the manufacturers or the suppliers to make the application. If the manufacturers think that they should not be subject to the regulation of the bill, they do not have to approach it. Is that right, Mr. Lai? Well, going by the experience of other schemes, for example, plastic shopping bag levy scheme, which is covered and which is not covered, well, the manufacturers will make inquiries with us, and then taking recommendations from us, they will follow the procedures accordingly. Well, why I raise that question, Chairman? Because there is bound to be a couple of manufacturers who would say that they are not subject to the regulation, but then the administration thinks otherwise. So they are not making the reports. So it's not just a matter of quantity, but they are actually not reporting to you at all. So what is the mechanism that you have in place to check on that? Now, you have a mechanism to check the volume, the differential, and if there is a fee that levy has to be paid but not unpaid, then you will chase them. But if they don't report to you at all, is there a mechanism whether you can check out on that? Mr. Lai, the products are sold on the market, people are drinking them, so we will be paying a close watch on the products offered in the market and whether to see whether the relevant manufacturers have made the registration. We will also make sample checks. And also in the bill, we said that they should keep records for our inspections to make sure that they have made the right or the accurate reports. Let me raise a suggestion. For new products, new drinks, they come on stream every month, every day. So the government must do a more stringent job in inspections and checking. So you should avoid a situation where the media find the irregularities earlier than you do, and then that will affect the implementation of your scheme. I think the administration has heard your views. For the other definitions contained in this paper, any further questions? Say, for example, a glass container's definition of consume. They have responded to our concerns in this paper. Legal advisor, is it the case that you have some views? Yes. my question. Well, stems out of the questions just raised by members, and that has to do with paragraph B in the definition. Can the administration explain to me and the members? Well, the way it is written here in B is that a product that is a liquid or consists of liquid and is commonly served as a drink after being diluted or reconstituted. Several members' question is if there are beverage products which consists of liquid or is a liquid, and they may serve more than one purpose. Say, for example, honey can be used for barbecue purpose on chicken wings, and if it is diluted, then it can be consumed as a drink. So I would like to clarify the legislative intent. Is it the case that you want to deal also with beverage products which can serve more than one purpose? I would like to have the legislative intent clear before I can further follow up with my questions. Chairman, based on the discussions just now, we have tried to explain that no matter how you draft it, there are bound to be cases which will be difficult to tackle. We have tried our best to draft the provisions as clear as possible. For 2B, the intent is that we would be able to deal with majority of beverage products which are in liquid form, and whether they will be used for drinks purposes. I think we would consider whether we would be adding, say, one or two sentence to clarify that. Yeah, that's our legislative intent. So thank you, administration, for clarifying your legislative intent. Now, I would like to focus on Roman letter 2. Now, the way it is written now is commonly served as a drink after being diluted. But then the way you said it is that you want to deal with substance which can be used for multiple purposes. So would that be the case that if it is just one of the purposes can be used as a drink, well, that would suffice for the purpose of the regulation? Now, would you also be saying categorically that the substance can also be used for other purposes? Now, if it is diluted and can be used as a drink, then that would come under the definition of B.
I think the question is that according to your definition, you say it is commonly served as a drink after being diluted. If you do not use the word commonly, you say it could be used as a drink after being diluted. Some people may promote the product saying that it's good for health if it is being diluted. Then it will have to be subject to regulation. If we say commonly, it means that although this can be done, but it's not commonly the way the product is being consumed. Is that your legislative intent? I think we used the word commonly, because we are thinking of some of the examples quoted by members earlier. For example, vinegar, which is used for direct consumption. For example, vinegar which is used to make salads or as a beverage if it is diluted. Then B2 would cover such products. We would say that we do not include them. If the vinegar is only used to make salad, then it will not be included. But fruit vinegar, which is consumed as beverages, although they're also vinegar, but in most cases they are diluted for consumption. So after use of the word commonly, this is why we've used the word commonly. Legal advisor, I'm grateful for the administration clarifying the legislative intent and what they want to cover and what they do not want to cover, so that it's all clearly in the record. I have one more question by Mr. Chen. Now, follow up. Now, for vinegar, normally it is a sauce or condiment, so it's not subject to the regulation, unless it is fruit vinegar. But what about, you know, vinegar cooked with ginger? It could be used as a sauce, but the sweet vinegar can also be consumed as a drink. Would you regard it as a food product, a condiment, a sauce, or vinegar? Mr. Ng, I think ginger vinegar, when it is consumed, normally we would also eat the ginger and the eggs. Using that as an example of a beverage is rather far-fetched. So it would be a food product rather than a drink. There is one more point about the amended definition and the coverage of your amended definition. I just want to clarify what is your framework. In paragraph 3 of your paper, the focus here is that there are other products which are exist in non-liquid form, either in powder form, which would dissolve in water, and it is consumed as beverages. I'm looking at A, you know, products which are diluted and consumed as a drink. And perhaps the administration can explain this. If in the market you have, drinks which have to be diluted before it is consumed, but the product itself may contain liquid and some materials which are chewable. For example, the drink contain liquid and also some substances which can be chewed. So I'd like to confirm whether it will fall under the definition of fruit juice or beverage. Anyway, it is sold in a mixed form. It is a beverage that can be drunk and it contains liquid and the other substance as well. Will it be also regulated? Yes, your understanding is correct. For example, you have orange drink with actual orange meat in it, but would still regard it as a beverage, and then it will fall under 2A. So I think that's the legislative intent is very clear then. Mr. Thomas Jiang, I'm sorry for being late. I think these regulations, I think we all want to regulate these products, but very often the devil is in the details. I understand Mr. Raymond Chan's question. We all know that vinegar can be consumed as a drink. You don't use it to take a bath. If you say, you know, one container of ginger and vinegar, then it can also be consumed. But we were cited as an example. We're talking about vinegar. You say vinegar could be consumed as a beverage, then it will be subject to regulation. So you allow fruit vinegar. Who is it to say that you cannot drink vinegar cooked with ginger? If I consume the pork knuckle, the egg, and the ginger, I do not eat the vinegar. I just drink the vinegar. Right? Or I swallow the vinegar. I do that all the time. So when you draft the bill, we have to ask how many types of fruit vinegar are sold in the market. If you take out fruit vinegar, don't talk about, you know, eating vinegar. Vinegar cooked with ginger and pork knuckle, nobody will eat the vinegar. And if there is a case in court, the judge will find it very difficult to make a decision. If you don't have such difficulties with fruit vinegar, I don't think you should go to such details. I mean, how nobody would say that you eat, vinegar in ginger and pork knuckles. So I don't think you should draft the bill in such a manner. I would rather you say vinegar is a sauce or a condiment, no matter how you use it. I mean, those glass containers, you're not setting up a fund to recycle the containers or the vinegars which I have swallowed. If we do that, it really would be, protecting the environment. When I was a kid, for example, you pay 30 cents for a bottle of Vitasoy. If I take the bottle back, I get a refund of 10 cents. I don't want you to impose a levy in the name of environmental protection. If I disagree with your proposal, you will say that I do not support environmental protection. So I think vinegar is a gray area. I've asked my two colleagues, one said that we should not include vinegar cooked with ginger, and somebody said that you should include them if it is consumed as a beverage, but not so if it is consumed as a food product. Mr. Cheung, in our early discussion before you came, and also at previous meetings, we've used vinegar as an example. Indeed, in the market, we have vinegar marketed sold as a beverage. As for vinegar cooked with ginger, the legal advisor already had asked a question, and some members also raised the same point. That is B bracket 2. The definition is that it is the product is commonly served as a drink after being diluted or reconstituted. So take vinegar cooked with ginger. After being diluted, it's right. It's all right that you can consume it as a drink. So is soy sauce. You can dilute it and drink it and say it's good for health. But the definition here is it's commonly served as a drink. For vinegar cooked with ginger, I wouldn't call it a drink. It's not a beverage, although you may say that it is in liquid form and consumed together with the ginger and the pork knuckle, I would still regard it as food rather than a drink. And I think a legal advisor asked the same question earlier. Sometimes you may have some borderline cases which during the enforcement stage, you need to have a more thorough discussion with the tray. But I think the legislative intent, it's very clear after our earlier discussion. Mr. Ng, would you have anything further to elaborate? Yes. Just leave vinegar alone. How many products are vinegar sold as beverages? You don't need to have such a narrow, delineation and split vinegar into two types, one for use as a consumer as a drink and another type consumed as a food product. Thank you, Mr. Jern, for that comment. I remember our original draft was more general. We include all drinks, including water. After many rounds of discussion, we wanted to give more examples and also stipulate what will be covered by our definition. We try the best to strike a balance. We don't agree that all the different types of beverages should be listed, and it's not possible. So we hope that our approach now is to strike a balance. While aiming for clarity, the definition should not be too narrow or too vague or exhausting all the categories that will be covered or not covered. Right. Do members have any further questions regarding the amendments in the paper? If not, shall we... Since some amendments have been moved for some of the provisions that we've already looked at, and they include sections 1 to 7 of the bill, so should we take some time to spend some time to go through them before we carry on with the other part of our clause-by-clause scrutiny. Since we now have all these new amendments, so we need to be cautious and take a look at them again. And I think we're looking at Annex B of the paper, right? Mr. Lai, Chairman, other than our discussion on this bill, last time we heard that the recycling of waste electrical and electronic products are also being scrutinized. And there are some similarities between the two bills. On the one hand, the recycling of electrical and electronic products, that bill will come into effect earlier than this one. Whereas for the recycling and proper disposal of product container amendments, they will need to be scrapped to avoid duplication. And the provision of this bill, that is recycling and proper disposal of product container, will need to be updated depending on the completion of the enactment of the WEE bill. And that's why we've moved these amendments. If we look at the bill, in clause 2, we have made an amendment to the numerals because we will be scrapping section 3, so we've amended the numeral there. The reason for scrapping section 3 is that in the WEE bill, there is a similar provision. So this has now become redundant upon the commencement of the WEE bill. Number 4A, definition of regulated article, again we've amended the numeral, having taken reference of the schedule in the WEE bill. Schedule 6 now is become schedule 8, and the same for some of the other updating as well. Section 5, we under the Eco Responsibility Bill, we've added Section 4. Originally, after adding plastic shopping bags, we've added regulated articles. Having made reference of the WEE Bill, it becomes regulated electrical appliances and regulated articles. Number six. In the original provision, we've added the WEE bill, so we scrapped 44 and it's now section 44 or 55. And then in clause section 7, we've added part 5 and added glass containers. The new section 47, we propose to amend several definitions, some of which are also related to the WEE bill. The first definition, dispatch or distribute. And after the definition, we've added, we say that the distribution does not include export, not including the export of such products in the course of business and regarding, so we've listened to the views of the Bills Committee scrutinizing the WEE bill, that is, it will not include export. Definition of supplier, again, making reference of the WEE bill, we've also made some amendments, some textual amendments, but the policy is not changed. Consumption, we've made reference of the legal advisor's point, we've also amended the definition to further clarify our intention. Section 48.1, it's again, we propose some textual amendments. Paragraph 2 normally deals with the export of regulated articles, and we spell out in the definition of distribution that it does not include export. So 48 bracket 2 is no longer required and therefore is scrapped. Section 50, we made reference of the WEE bill and have now moved an amendment accordingly, same for 51. And next, 54, again, Making reference of the WEE bill, we've made some textual amendments. 55, it's the same. Some updating of the numerals. Same for 56.
The same goes for
57. And in Schedule 8, which is originally Schedule 6, based on the discussions at the Bills Committee today, we will be proposing amendments on the definition of beverage. This has not been reflected in this Annex B. And so that's the point where we stopped at the last meeting. Members, any views on the amendments just discussed now? On the definition of beverage, if we accept the proposed amendment to the definition of beverage today, AB, then that would also be included in the bill, right? Legal advisor, can the government clarify on this? With regard to the definition of consume, that will be changed. That will affect the original 35, and that is the 51 now. And that is the registered supplier must pay container recycling fee. So I would like the administration to tell members clearly that in relation to the changed amendment of the definition of consume, and that is under the new section 51, the original 35, the registered supplier, now if he opens the sealed container and he needs to pay the recycling fee or levy. Well, if he opens up the container, he will not export it. I can't imagine that he can export a container which has been opened up. So can you clarify that point? Mr. Lai, the legal advisor's point is that last time, if the supplier uses the container and not the beverage, then that would not be covered under the original definition of consume. So that's why we make it clearer this time, and that is to say that this supplier, as long as he opens for the first time after the container is sealed, he will be subject to the levy, irrespective of whether he uses or not. Well, please note that I'm not here to nitpick you. We just want to make it clear on the definition. And can the administration tell us the legal consequence after the definition has been amended, if that section is breached? So if there is no further question, then we will continue with the clause-by-clause scrutiny. Mr. Lai, please. We now deal with the amendments to the Waste Disposal Ordinance. And in Annex B of this latest paper, we have further amendments to propose. Mr. Tommy Zhang, can you please speak closer to the mic? I'm not hearing you clearly. In Annex B, there are further amendments. So I would be discussing the amendments on the two papers at the same time. First of all, we propose to amend Section 2 of the Waste Disposal Ordinance, and that is the disposal definition, and also add in the definition of container waste, and also the amending the definition of waste. Now, we would like to say that in relation to disposal, and in relation to e-waste includes storage, treatment, reprocessing, and recycling, but does not include reuse. You can see that in Section 16, or Clause 16, we said that when you store and reprocess the glass containers, you should get a license. And in Annex B, we said that in the WEE bill, there are relevant amendments in relation to the recycling of e-waste. So we would be proposing amendments and merge the two amendments together. In relation to the definition of container waste, there are two parts. One is paragraph A, and that is, judging by its experience, is a container specified in Schedule 6 of the Product Eco-Responsibility Ordinance. So if there is a broadening of the definition in the future, then this part will also be broadened correspondingly. And this, the second definition is that the container waste has been abandoned. And in clause 2, we have the definition of waste. We talk about different types of waste, and we add in the word container waste there. So this is a amendment to clause 2. Please continue. Then we come to amending section 16, and that is the prohibition of unauthorized disposal of waste and waste that has to be disposed with a license. Right now, we are targeting the chemical waste and medical waste where a license is required. And in the future, where there is electronic waste, a relevant provision has to be added in. And for also container waste, there is a corresponding provision. So we suggest that under section 16, we will add in after 2A, we would add in three exemptions. And that is, if the volume processed today is less than 1 ton per day, so this is a small scale operation, so that should be subject to exemption. So they don't have to apply for a license under section 16. With regard to storage, there are two exemptions. One is that the total volume of container waste would not exceed 50 cubic meters, that is smaller than the container, then that is considered a small scale storage. That is equivalent to that in the electronic waste. And the second exemption.
我哋原意要呢一个嘅处理，呢个储存嘅地点所要相关嘅要求咧，其实都已经满足咗，咁所以我哋都豁免。咁呢个安排咧，亦都系同电器废物嗰个安排咧系一致嘅。咁呢三方面嘅处喺储存同埋处理嘅方面咧，如果呢个经营系属于呢三方面咧，系唔需要攞我哋嘅牌照嘅。咁接住落嚟咧，我哋建议加入二A条啦。 咁呢個主要咧就係話喺生產制冧計劃底下咧，我哋預計咧喺呢啲二另有牌照嘅回收商咧，佢哋可能係會有新嘅商機。咁所以儘管佢哋可能係小規模經營，唔符合或者佢符合我哋剛才提嘅相關嘅豁免條款咧，我哋都容許佢有一個嘅途徑咧，去主動去申領呢個牌照嘅。咁相關嘅申領嘅手續啊，或者我哋考慮嗰個嘅條件咧，其實都係一樣嘅。 咁呢個同電器廢物嗰個做法亦都一致。咁亦都係二 B 條咧就會係有一個賦權咧，讓環境局局長咧可以喺諮詢環境諮詢委員會之後咧，係用先訂立後審議嘅先審議後訂立嘅程序咧，係修訂個剛才嘅提及50立方米或者每日處理1公噸呢啲咁樣嘅數字嘅。咁呢個可以喺個豁免嘅條款裏面咧係有一啲調整。
咁呢個係調整嘅機制。好，咁啊，對於16呢度嘅修訂，大家有冇意見？呢部分主要就係講。
So section 16 amendment, any further views? So that has to do with the premises for storing the waste, and also there is amendment in relation to 2A and 2B. Any views? Can the administration tell members in relation to the amendments to the blue bill of WEEE? The government has made amendments to 20G of the Waste Disposal Ordinance. that the amendment was outlined in the blue bill, stating what defenses that the supplier can make. But looking at this present blue bill, there is no mentioning similar to that for that WEE bill 20G. Maybe, what is your legislative intent? Maybe that is needed for that other bill and not for this one. The background is different. If you have taken part in the scrutiny of the WEE bill, we are regulating the four types of electrical appliances and also computer in relation to TV, computer and other electric appliances. We have a technical definition for every type of product. Now, when it comes to the waste disposal ordinance, when we're implementing it, we can only judge by experience whether this is a set of TV or what. And there is no way that we can judge whether they meet with the technical definition. So the scope may be wider. So that's why we have provided for a mechanism for the supplier to make a defense, and they may say that this that their products do not meet with the definition of TV. Oh, and because for glass containers we don't have a definition, so there is no need for a provision on defense for the suppliers. Well, thank you, the administration, for making that distinction for us. Thank you, legal advisor. If you don't have any problem with 60, then we will go to 20A and 20B, and these have to do with the import and export of waste, and a license is required or a permit is required. The present regulation targets toxic materials where import and export requires a license. And under the existing regulation, there may be circumstances where a permit is required. But as long as it's a container waste in the future, a permit is required. So that is the same as the WEE bill. So in Annex B, we have added in this provision in relation to container waste, and a new provision is added to 20A and 20B. Export and import permit system. No further question. All right, so Mr. Lai. So we've redrafted 21A, the last amendment. For different wastes, if they have to apply for a license, what are the conditions required? So in terms of the chemical waste, clinical waste, and so on, we have improved on the drafting, and we've added in the electronic waste and also container waste here. Thank you. Any further views? If not, then we'll go on to the next part then. So that's it for this bill. So the next part is the English version then. Members, we are done with the close-by-close scrutiny of the Chinese version of the bill. And there is the English version as well.
I'd like to ask our legal advisor and members whether you have any comments regarding the English version of the bill. Would you want to go through each of the clauses? And if there's no problem, legal you suggest that we ask the legal advisor to go through the text of the English version. So is there any point that the legal advisor would like to raise at this stage regarding the English version? No? Legal advisor, please speak up. Another question for the administration. Apparently, you've amended 603, kept 603 and the Waste Disposal Ordinance. I think you also need to, I think we would look at we depend on the progress of the WEE bill before we can come to a final decision. So the numbering of the provisions of the bill may not be final. Perhaps when the government submit this, we may need to look at the final version and check the cross-referencing. So if the WEE bill is, you know, enacted in whole, then fine. Otherwise, you may need to further fine-tune the text of this bill. So regarding the numbering of the sections, I mean, they may not be final. I believe we all know that. Regarding the WEEE bill, it is scheduled for tomorrow's sitting. At the House Committee, I've also submitted my report. But regarding the product container amendment bill, should there be a need to further amend this? We'll let members know. Basically, it will only be about the numbering. This, if they use a certain term in the WEE bill, then we can use the same terminology in this bill. But if certain things are not accepted, then I don't know what the administration will do. They may need to, ensure that the same definition in the two bills will not be drafted in a different way. So should members move the amendment, should the administration move an amendment to move a CSA to amend the wordings in the WEE bill? I think for the WEE bill, the administration has moved some amendments to correct the terminologies. Of course, members have also moved some amendments, but not so in respect of the terminologies. I think if it is moved by the government, it will always be approved. So for the CSAs moved by the administration, well, members of that bill's committee had scrutinized those amendments very carefully. And we've also concluded our cross-by-cross scrutiny of this bill. I believe the government will need to submit the draft CSAs, especially the part concerning the definitions. So do we need to convene another meeting? But I think if it will depend on members' views after the administration has given us this further information. If members think that there is a need for another meeting, we have arranged for a slot to do that. But if after circulation members have no further views, then we may not need to have another meeting. Originally, we've scheduled the next meeting for the 23rd of February at 8:30. I think we can still, reserve maintain the flexibility. I think before the 23rd of this month, I'm sure all the amendments to the terminologies would be ready and circulated to us. Yes, certainly we will, forward those amendments to members before that. If the administration could do that earlier, then we will have some time to look at them and reflect on them and decide whether we need to have another meeting on the 23rd. So don't, send us such information at too late a stage. Otherwise, we wouldn't have enough time. Members, do any members wish to move any CSAs? Ms. Andrew-Lau. Question for the administration. Earlier, I've asked the question already. The government's intention is to encourage the industry to recycle these glass bottles. I've already asked the administration, and they told me that they would talk to the trade as to how we can encourage them to recycle glass containers, and also asked them whether or not the recyclers will not treat these recycled containers but sell them to the producers. And also the 80% recycling threshold could be steadily reduced. I mean, you can start with a lower threshold. For the producers, they've told us that you can't make 80% at the beginning. So I'd like to know what is the outcome of the government's negotiation with the trade before I decide whether to move a CSA. Thank you, Chairman. regarding the reuse of glass containers. We certainly encourage that. If the producers can collect the glass bottles, they can apply for an exemption. Regarding the producers of the glass containers and what is the progress of our discussion with them, we've actually approached several producers. Some of them, in principle, could be given exemptions, but there are some producers which we're still talking to them, and we haven't yet decided what whether they will be able to operate in a manner that would qualify them for exemption. I think the 80% recycling threshold, how does the administration intend to deal with that? Will you allow for some flexibility? Are you going to steadily, you know, raise the threshold? I would like to recycle up to 80%, but then I can start at a lower level, but gradually I will add more and more bottles. So I don't think you should start right at the beginning with an 80% threshold. If the threshold is too high, I simply cannot make it. Could you start with 40% so that I can steadily raise it to 80% after some time? And for those bottles which cannot be recycled, how should we deal with them? I'll ask Mr. Lai to respond. Chairman, I also like to clarify that in our paper, we understand that we have beverage companies and dairy companies have certain recycling arrangements. At the Bills Committee, we heard some manufacturers who are interested in coming up with some recycling plan, and they told us that they will not do it like the beverage, the soft drink, the beverage manufacturers. So we are aware of that, and we've explained to them that in the Blue Bill, the mechanism would allow them to put in an application so long as they submit a waste reduction plan telling us how they intend to recycle these glass containers for reuse. And if the proposal is feasible and serve the purpose of waste reduction, then under this framework, we have the flexibility to allow them some exemptions. In our internal discussion, we've also confirmed this. We will continue to talk to them, and we will provide for these provisions clearly in the subsidiary legislation. Mr. Leung, I think it's good that you have discussions with them. Ultimately, I think we're aiming at the recycling of waste products. We hope that the Secretary will, during the second reading of the bill, would state that if people say they want to do this, the government should provide them with the incentive to recycle glass bottles so that the trade would know and can benefit from this, because eventually we just want glass bottles to be reused rather than being, you know, turned into, you know, sea sand substitute. Where during the resumption of the second reading, we certainly, you know, do that. Regarding exemptions, looking at Section 40, Part 5, A, B, C, D, I think this already gave the director lots of powers to grant exemption. The director may, in respect of the following matters, and grant exemptions. For example, an application for fee prescribed by the regulated articles of regulation, a container waste reduction plan, and so on. So, or any other matter the director considers appropriate. So Mr. Leung is suggesting that we should start with a lower threshold and then gradually tighten the threshold. Well, the provision is here, but whether or not the director exercises such power is his discretion. But I want some clarity here, that is, if somebody can, you know, satisfy the requirement, the director will give him that exemption. I want the director, the secretary, to stipulate this clearly, that he would encourage people to talk to the government so that we can recycle and reuse glass bottles. Thank you, Mr. Leung. I think in the course of our deliberations, I see that all of us are very consistent. And I think our thinkings are also in line with the government's. Mr. Leung suggested that during the second reading of the bill, the Secretary in his speech can also clearly spell out the policy objective of this bill. And at the implementation stage, we will closely monitor the administration, and after some time, they can report to us about the implementation. Any CSAs that members like to move today? Of course, we still have time. If members, after further consideration, would like to move amendments. So when the papers in respect of the further CSAs are available, we will decide whether we need to have another meeting on the 23rd. Okay? Thank you very much, members. We are now adjourned.